I'm now going to ask Ajay to say something about his journey. I met him a few weeks ago and I was really amazed at his ability to take three or four businesses and bring them all under one single brand called Aditya Birla Capital. How he managed it, how the journey started, how did he observe the behavior of the consumers, and how he configured the brand so that it could be relevant to all of them. That's Ajay.
Thanks, Kiran. I know we're very short of time, and I'm not sure if you want to hear more about my brand than you want to hear about the consumer. So let me just try and do a quick mix. A few facets on the millennium we're speaking about, that if he's about 22 to 37 years old, there's a dichotomy out there, right? He is somewhere early in his career. On the other hand, at the other end of the spectrum, he is reaching the prime working and earning years of his life. And the numbers which we have seen circulating around, Morgan Stanley says that by 2020, there will be about 410 million millennials with a spend of $330 billion annually. And Morgan Stanley believes that that is more than the total population of US and more than the current number of millennials in China. So there's no question about millennials being important or not, but I wanted to just leave behind a thought at this stage about millennials, that while for some categories they're a ripe audience, for some categories it may be an investment audience, because the category determines the audience and not necessarily the other way around. So I represent a brand, Aditya Birla, and I'm sure all of you have heard of it. It has its roots in the East, and it has a history that we are very proud of. And it's a very trusted brand. And when I represent a category which is trust, which is financial services, it's a great coming together of a brand and a category. But the one question we were faced was that I can do without steel, with due respect. I can do without a watch, with due respect. I can do without Amul, the taste of India. But how can anyone do without money? Because roti ho, kapda ho, ya makan ho, you need money. And the challenge in front of us that Kiran spoke about was that, how is it that a category called mobile has higher penetration than a category called money? I can live without mobile, I cannot live without money. And yet we represented a mutual fund category with about 5% penetration, health insurance about 4%, life insurance about 17%. And we went to the consumer, and we went to all the consumers of today and the consumers of tomorrow. And we found one thing common, that our category is more about us and less about the consumer. I don't know if you heard the old joke that the best way to lose a friend is to become an insurance agent. Because you will chase your friend and your friend will run away, because he'll say, what happened to my friend? Now he suddenly wants my money. The problem with our category is that while it's universal and relevant to every living person in this world, nobody understands why a financial services brand. They all think there's something in it for the manufacturer. The consumer doesn't know what's in it for him. Therefore, what we did was we took the pedigreed brand of Aditya Birla, which was known around the country, but was not known for its financial services business. And very similar to Amul, we adopted a mother brand strategy. It's the first mother brand strategy in the Indian financial services industry, and I don't see another one coming in the near future. But our purpose was, how do we make money to every audience for all his needs throughout his life cycle? Therefore, the category of bank, mutual fund, life insurance, health insurance, wealth management, blah, 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 which is our language, and the consumer told us he doesn't understand. We brought it together under three words which he relates to, and research showed us that he wants to protect his dreams, and therefore he wants protecting solutions. He wants to invest money to live his dreams tomorrow. Therefore, we brought investing solutions. And the younger generation wants tomorrow's dreams to happen today. Therefore, he wants financing solutions. So a category which is more known by its products We brought it by consumer speak. There is Aditya Birla, the most trusted brand you could ever want or desire in the context of financial services. Capital, which represents all shades of money. And in consumer speak, we offer three sets of solutions: protecting, investing, and financing. And the millennial taught us that financial services are so intangible, you can't touch, feel, or experience it. They wanted advice. They wanted hand-holding, whether it's online or offline. And therefore, the fourth pillar of our offering is advice. Protecting, investing, financing, advising. So I just want to leave you behind with this thought that even if you have a pedigreed brand, you have a pedigreed category, the consumer is not pedigreed. That pedigree is changing every day, every year, every month. And therefore, there was an old song of Amitabh Bachchan, Kabhi Kabhi. Main pal do pal ka shayar hoon, pal do pal meri kahani hai. I think today when we are discussing millennials, tomorrow we will discuss Brand Z, and day after we will discuss I don't know whom. The consumer will keep changing. For us to assume any one is more important than the other may be a fallacy. And while we are talking about millennials, the one fallacy I want to leave behind this audience is that we look at millennials as one category. We look at millennials as one homogeneous category. In my mind, that is like when you look at the sun signs in the newspapers, every human being in the world is divided into 12 sun signs. We assume that a scorpion is like this and every scorpion in the world is exactly the same. That is not true. I think we should look at millennials like we looked like the Janampatri. Everyone's Janampatri is very unique. You and your twin brother will have nearly the same time, definitely the same date of birth, but your kundli will be very different. You're a different human being. Your wants, needs, desires are very different. So my leave behind thought to this August gathering is that don't take your brand for granted, don't take your category for granted, don't take your consumer for granted, and most definitely don't take a millennial for granted. Because every millennial is different. And every millennial has to be understood and spoken to in his language. Otherwise, for a millennial X, if you speak one common language, it's as if you're speaking to somebody else, not to him. Thank you.
That was brilliant. That's exactly what I was talking about, Ajay, that the millennials, they look like an elephant, but they have various parts. I'm going to now ask Abhijit to take over and the same thing that Ajay did, short and crisp.
Yeah, sure.
We want the audience to ask more questions then.
Sure. So thanks, Kiran, and pleasure to be part of this panel, and great to be here in Calcutta presenting quite a few familiar people with whom I worked in the past. So what I'll do is have a short presentation on how we at SEAT have gone on this journey of millennials. I have two parts to it, one on the communication and the brand consideration front, and one, how we've gone on the purchase journey. So before that, get into one small experiment. How many of us would really know what tire we have on our cars or on our bikes? Most likely, very few, most likely, and neither did I. In fact, on the day I was joining SEAT, I went in, I peered under my car, I saw what tire do I have. At least if somebody asked me, I would appear knowledgeable. So it's really not a category most of us think about too much. It's not a category we are excited about too much. You're definitely not thinking about your category the way that you would think of, buying, let's say, your next mobile phone or, maybe a pair of, running shoes or something. You really don't think about, you're not excited about buying this. Now, in that context, the question is, how do you create, consideration for a brand? How do you, make it the unmistakable brand that people will buy when they go to the shop? And what we've done there is take up a very functional need, a very core need for the category. Tires exist in a pain area. Your first reaction would be when to change a tire is, damn, I've got a flat tire, I need to change my tire, it's old. So you've taken the need for a tire which is, providing you safety, which is essentially giving you, that peace of mind that you can ride peacefully all the time. So we've taken a functional need of saying, my tires provide the best grip and hence they provide the best safety, and build our communication on that. Some of our communication we've seen, this whole campaign of, streets are filled with idiots was fairly visible. And what we thought we did in that was we picked up the lingo, we picked up characters, we made the situations a little flippant. We took up, you know, slices of life which a young rider would face, and we thought that we were speaking to, you know, the young people. But what we realized along the way was that the millennial that we're talking about is a little distrusting of advertising. So, you know, he's constantly being marketed to. So he's not so trusting of advertising, and hence, you know, this marketing messaging is potentially getting a little filtered. So we said, okay, what can we do beyond this? And hence, when we looked at millennials, what we kind of realized was one of the key things is that, you know, for him, causes are important. And we said that, okay, are there causes which we could take up, which resonates with what we want to say on the brand, and which will take the, you know, the story and the brand forward? Our communication, mass communication, has taken the brand forward, but somewhere, you know, that connect with the millennials was potentially something that we could do. So we said, listen, we are about safety. We talk about that. And could we hence take building safety on roads as a cause that we could stand for? And so in this context, we said, okay, our communication is not only to millennials. We sell tires to everybody. So our communication will be on mass medium. And it will continue the tonality that we have. It will continue to have those, you know, slices of life, those road insights that we continue to have. But could we look at things like digital or essentially other more specialized medium to talk about road safety from a cause point of view? And that's what we kind of did. So this is, basically how we tried to make Indian roads safer through some of this. So first video that was against overspeeding. We did something, a short video on this.
Overspeeding is a leading cause of road accidents. Every adult knows this, but not everyone follows the rules. That's why we decided to talk to kids instead. During the World Road Safety Week, SEAT approached schools to teach kids about road safety. But kids, who are already so observant, had a little something to say to their dads.
Dad, I get very scared when you go room. Dad, please don't drive so fast.
Presenting the Drive Safe Dad bobblehead. We created bobbleheads that looked exactly like the kids. Fitted with a sound chip that's synchronized with the speedometer, the bobblehead gives out a message every time the car exceeds its speed limit while saying no to speeding. With this, SEAT helped the kids say "Drive safe, Dad" in an interesting way. Loved this gift and have promised to be more responsible drivers. We aim to meet many more kids and create many more bobbleheads so they can tell their dads,
"Drive safe, Dad."
An initiative by SEAT Tires. SEAT, it helps.
Please like and share this video.
So very, very squarely, a communication which is in the space that we talk about. And again, you're, you know, bringing a cause and with a very nice insight that, you know, parents potentially would, or dads potentially would listen to what the children would say. So something very, very clearly on the brand, that's what we did. And we've done some other stuff like this following this. What I'll show you is another video where we've taken this cause of safety now to a slightly higher level. This is very squarely on the product benefit, but we've taken to the higher, a higher level, which is essentially for women's safety. And again, I'll play the video.
India, a country where an act of crime against women is committed every 2 minutes. Women, on the other hand, fight back with their biggest weapon, normalcy.
ये रोड देख रहे हो? अभी तो ये एकदम सेफ है. पर जैसे यहाँ एम का पीएम हो जाता समझो लोगों की मेंटालिटी बदल जाती है बैग में है ना पेपर स्प्रे, बट अगर रास्ते में कुछ हुआ तो am I gonna look for it?
स्पीड डायल भी भैया का नंबर तो है, लेकिन कुछ हो गया तो वो भी घर बैठे क्या करेंगे, जो भी करना है मुझे ही करना है.
SEAT, a brand that stands for safety, swore to do something about it. We decided to make the very mode of transport used by thousands of women safe. Presenting the SEAT Safety Grip. Tactfully concealed in the bike's accelerator throttle is a pepper spray. Every time a woman feels threatened on or around her bike, her pepper spray is well within her reach. The spray can be pulled out and used immediately. The SEAT Safety Grip is designed to empower women, so nothing can ever stop them. Because we've kept them safe on the road, now we'll keep them safe off it. It helps.
So clearly, again, taking the, you know, the premise of safety actually beyond the product, and now having a higher order connect with the entire proposition of safety, and it's really got a lot of millennial love for us. So those are some of those reviews on Amazon. People seem to love it, and again, some of the Facebook comments and social media comments. So people really seem to like these sort of things, and it's not only likes and love. Hardcore brand measures also seem to have gone up. Clear brand track data showing, you know, associations with safety, which is essentially the parameter that we want to drive. Modernity of the brand, most likely to buy, purchase consideration, everything gone up. And very interestingly, in this category, what we are noticing is safety, which is potentially you would think of as a hygiene parameter, is actually, which we stand for, is actually becoming far more important as a driver for purchase consideration. So, you know, you are actually squarely positioning yourself and making that need far, far more important for the consumer. So this is what a lot of this, you know, cause-based marketing has done for this consumer. And this is how, you know, it's helped us, you know, being stronger on the brand. I'll quickly take another part, which is, you know, how do millennials buy us and do millennials buy us differently? And what we did was we plotted the millennial buying journey. And what we noted was, you know, these are the various personas. So when we plotted the decision journey, very clearly this persona buys very, very differently from a non-millennial persona. He looks for a greater, we know, you know, the millennial consumer looks for greater control, greater information on his entire buying process. He's his, you know, his own doctor, he's his own financial advisor. He's looking for information online. He's doing all of that. So in this, his sources of awareness is essentially digital. His pre-purchase is going through, you know, discussion forums and searches and things of that sort. And, you know, even he wants his warranty registration to be a digitized process. And there were great learnings for us in how you kind of do this. And we kind of realized that, you know, because this persona is a little, you know, less trusting of advertising, is a function of also he's grown up in an area of, you know, where trust is a difficult commodity. The millennial doesn't really trust, you know, too many institutions around him. One of the things that he's looking for is strong associations for a brand. So for example, if a vehicle manufacturer were to have a strong recommendation for your brand, it would be one of the reasons why he would buy you. And this is just to compare with a pre-millennial persona whose sources of awareness are things like mechanics. He goes to you know, multi-dealer, multi-brand dealer outlets, and because he thinks that is a sort of neutral person that's there. So just to give a sense as to how it kind of translates into different marketing programs. For the millennial persona, there is this entire piece on digital where you're working with, you know, creating digital assets, creating influencers, working with key opinion leaders, and actually taking leads from online sources and actually marketing to them. Whereas for a pre-millennial consumer persona, you're creating programs for influencers like mechanics. You're essentially helping the salesman in the multi-brand store sell him more. And of course, this entire thing on making the warranty process far more digital. So just to summarize, I mean, clearly, I think the difference, I mean, both are looking at influencers. One is looking at online influencers versus an offline influencer. One person is looking at information on demand because he is far more information savvy. For somebody, you push information through more mass media sources. Somebody wants to control the buying process, you know, omni-channel. versus somebody for other person, you enable the buying process because he's looking at help in helping to buy the tire. So you help him in these various touch points at both at an awareness purchase, pre-purchase and purchase stage. So that's, I think, how the decision, the purchase journey is different for a millennial consumer versus a pre-millennial consumer. And that's kind of summarizes what we do on this.
Thank you, Abhijit. Thank you. Very enlightening. So one of the things I like about gatherings like this is the amount of learning I get to do. So what the plan now is that I'm going to start the questions by asking just one single question from my side to each one of the panelists, and then I'm going to give you at least 10 minutes to ask your questions until we start the next session. So Suparna, what I learned from you is that the millennial or the youngster, doesn't matter how we define it, is a moving target, right? You have tracked their progress from self-experimentation to self-expression, to experimentation, to rebellion, to authenticity. What is the method? How do you manage to have this very insightful understanding of this young person? Because over 20 years, they have gone through three or four different phases. How did you manage this?
So it's a combination of science and art.
Okay.
There is a lot of science, the traditional science of consumer research, and we do a lot of consumer studies, both insight mining as well as behavior tracking. We have data coming in from, we have 185 fast track stores where day in and day out, consumers are coming in, and we get a lot of information from them. So that's the science part, which is brand tracks, consumers, scores, NPS scores from stores, etc., etc. And on the other side is the art part, which is, I would say, also gleaning the nuggets from what consumers are saying, which may have nothing to do with your brand or even your category. And earlier, this used to be done typically, you know, through either panels or depth interviews or group discussions. Increasingly, that is being supplemented by a lot of online listening. It's interesting because I think it's the journey is, sometimes you start with a hypothesis and then you seek information and data to validate it. And sometimes you start with nothing and you're just going out and trying to see where the pulse is going. And then you arrive at some kind of a hypothesis. Sometimes it's from the other side that, you know, a bunch of data when analyzed, and now of course also there's e-commerce data. We have our own e-commerce fasttrack.in from where we get data. And, you know, it's very easy to understand what people are rejecting and what they're more interested in, or even data from marketplaces. So all of that, sometimes the data presents something that you don't know what it means, and then you have to go behind the data to figure out what could be the possible psychological reason for this. So I think the whole science and art of consumer behavior has become very fascinating. Earlier, it used to be more one way, where companies were interested and brands were interested. Now, I think consumers say a lot. The data is an avalanche of data. The trick is in finding what is the nugget.
Correct.
And that requires the craft of it.
Yeah, lovely. So one of the things I keep saying is brands are now psychologically owned by multiple stakeholders, which is what Suparna is saying. So the data comes from the stakeholders, and it is the marketer's responsibility to find out what is right in that avalanche of data. Sarvesh, what I learned from you is that you have been able to pivot your entire company from being a product brand company to a service brand company, right? Branded steel is close to 20 or 30% of your turnover now. What did this entail? How did the internal audiences, how did you help them learn that, look, we have to pivot, we are not going to just manufacture steel rolls, but we are going to manufacture stuff which is central to the consumer's life. So what were their internal barriers? Did you do training? How did you inspire the internal audience to help the company shift from a product brand company to a service brand company?
Thanks, Kevin. That's a very interesting question. And you know, the first challenge, if I can use that word, Kevin, was to change our own mindset. You know, and we were into a commodity kind of a trade where the people who used to do business for us was a guy who has four phones in front of him, gadda around him, and all the selling used to do on price. So you used to call up people around this countryside, pitch Tata Steel's product, price of the product versus the price of the competition. So the first step was to, how do you change the company first? And first thing we started doing was that getting people, and all kudos to the leadership team there, was to start getting people from FMCG kind of a background into the system. So we have guys from Levers, we had guys from Procter Gamble, they started filtering in and they started occupying key positions in the company. We created a profile of category manager or brand manager, which I think he talked about. And we had people's position at that level. First change was to sprinkle the organization with people who knew what brand is. The first change. Second was to, how do you make the distribution channel? The second was that, how do you create the product which is seen as a differentiator? Because brand is not only putting a name of the product, but giving a value which the consumer understands as a value. So a lot went around that in terms of, as I talked about, in terms of giving it a product identity. I'll just give you one small example. You know, we sell corrugated sheet under Tata Shakti. And it's used by a farmer. He earns 6,000 to 8,000 rupees a month. His biggest pain point was that if he goes to buy eight, nine corrugated sheets, he gets cheated on the weight, on the thickness of the sheet. We said, no, we will print the thickness on each individual sheet. And the guy comes, farmers comes and said, "Tumko 40 number ka Tata ka shakti material chahiye." Now, the kind of resistance we faced from the retailer was immense. Because we were actually hitting his earnings. There was cheating going on. And so the whole mindset change of the retailers, the training them, huge money was spent. You know, we spent our retailers, our distributors, the team. You see, we have a setup in Pune where we send them in batches, training them about what the new business looks like. And it involved a lot of effort. We actually worked with McKinsey's of the world and to get some insights into how a distribution model looks at. We looked at various models, Asian Paint model, Procter & Gamble model, and looked at a model which would be more suitable for our kind of a business.
Brilliant, brilliant. Ajay, what I learned from you is that the millennials are not a homogeneous bunch, right? They are not an elephant. The other thing that you mentioned was you don't need to specifically appeal to one segment, you can talk to all segments. Those of you have not read this book called How